Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this webinar on NASH 2020 Myeloma and AL Amyloidosis Highlights. My name is Ana Vallejo. I'm the Communications Manager of Myeloma Patients Europe, and I will moderate this webinar today. First of all, I would like to thank you all for attending this webinar. As you know, our main goal with this webinar is to review the most important updates on myeloma and AL amyloidosis treatments presented at us at the American Society of Hematology annual meeting that was held virtually last week. For your information, this webinar will be fully recorded and will be uploaded to the Myeloma Patients Europe website, which is www.mpeurope.org, and will be available in the MPE YouTube channel as well. And before we start, I just would like to make a small summary of the webinar agenda. As you know, this webinar is scheduled for 5 to 6, so the presentation will last about 40-45 minutes, and then I will open the session for questions. So you have 2 ways to ask questions to the doctors. One of them is using the microphone in your computer. You just have to press the right hand button, and I will unmute you so you can ask directly your question to the doctors. And the other way, if you don't want to use your microphone, you can send your question in writing in the question and answer window. I will receive those questions and I will ask them to the doctor so they can answer them. As you know, this talk will be given by Dr. Cass Hoon and Claudia Steige. I hope I pronounced correct your name, and the VU University Medical Center in Amsterdam, the Netherlands. And on behalf of Myeloma Patient Europe doctors, I would like to thank you both for your collaboration, for your time to prepare and to give this webinar, and for the effort to summarize all the updates presented at us around myeloma and AL amyloidosis. So thank you very much, and the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you for the introduction. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Cas Groen, and I'm an internal medicine hematologist here in the Amsterdam UMC.
And I'm Claudia Steige. You pronounced it well, Anna. And I am a hematologist in training, but I'm doing my PhD in multiple myeloma.
In the upcoming 40 minutes, we'll try to guide you through all the highlights of the ASH 2020 about multiple myeloma and AL amyloidosis. What we're going to tell you today, first I want to give you an introduction about how studies work and medicine are developed. Then the first studies we'll talk you through is the newly diagnosed multiple myeloma and the role of stem cell transplant. The next thing is when the disease relapses and an early relapse, how can we treat it? And the next phase will be when it relapses after more relapses, so the late relapse. And then we're going to talk about the exciting new therapies like bispecific and CAR T cells and how they work. And we want to end this presentation with a little bit about AL amyloidosis and some take home messages. And after that, there will be more room for questions. So let's start with the beginning. It's good to realize that most treatments for multiple myeloma are combinations of different types of medicine. So mostly we combine an IMiD, an immunomodulatory drug like thalidomide or lenalidomide, with a proteasome inhibitor like bortezomib or carfilzomib. Recently, fairly new, is the anti-CD38 antibody daratumumab. It's been on the market for a few years, and more combinations with an IMiD or a proteasome inhibitor are tested and given. New in the field of treatment is the bispecific antibodies and the CAR T-cell therapy we will tell you later more about. When a drug is studied for the first time, it's studied in a phase 1 study. It means that they start at a low dose, and when the drug is safely administered, the doses are increased until they found the recommended phase 2 dose. Then at that dosage, a drug can enter a phase 2 study. And in this study, they'll further assess the safety and also will look at the effectiveness of a drug. When you find a drug which is safe and effective, it can be entered into a phase 3 study. And that means that this drug is given and compared to a current treatment and to see if it's even better than the drugs we have today. If a drug is approved and went through a phase 3 study and is safe and effective, based on this evidence, the EMA, which is the European Medicine Agency, can approve the drug. The next step that has to be taken per country is that the drug is also allowed to be given in your country and reimbursed. So that means that actually it's paid for. It's good to remind that we present also phase 1 and phase 2 studies, and this means that those new drugs are not directly available in your country for treatment, and it takes a while before the drugs is actually allowed to give outside of a study. In studies, a lot of numbers are mentioned, so it can be dazzling a little bit. The most important thing to remember is the ORR, which is called the overall response rate. Here you see an example with an ORR of 29%, meaning that 29% of the patients are reacting to the treatment and with a reduction in the M protein. When it's a partial response, there's a reduction of 50 to 90%. If there is a more reduction, higher than 90%, we call it a very good partial response. And if there is 100% reduction in the M protein, we call it a complete response. This is to show in studies how good the response is. Relatively new is the MRD, which stands for minimal residual disease. This is a more sensitive way of detecting plasma cells, multiple myeloma cells, in the bone marrow and see if 1 in 10,000 or 100,000 cells are still from the disease. Other numbers which are mentioned in studies are PFS, which stands for progression-free survival. The first thing to know is that when this line is higher, it's better. When we talk about a median PFS, that means that when 50% of all patients at a certain time point are still alive without progression of the disease. So for the treatment with the blue arm, the median PFS is 42 months, while with the other treatment, it's 57 months, which is longer, therefore better. Sometimes studies talk about a 12-month PFS or 24-month PFS. A 12-month PFS means that at 12 months, you can see how many people are still alive or without progression of the disease, and the higher, the better. Just remember, the higher, the better. Also important in studies are side effects. And to be able to research them, we classify them in grades, being grade 1 and 2, relatively mild. Grade 3 or 4 is more severe, so you don't want that. And grade 5 actually means that patients can die from this side effect.
So today we are going to give you the highlights of the ASH. And first, it's good to know that a lot of presentations investigated therapies for patients treated with newly diagnosed multiple myeloma, but many more presentations were about therapies for relapsed and refractory myeloma, and even actually more studies were investigated therapies preclinically. That means in mice or other animals or even cell lines in a laboratory. But I think for you, it's most clinically relevant to only talk about the human studies. So let us start by presenting the main results for the newly diagnosed multiple myeloma patients. And like Cas already told you, we can divide those patients between patients who are eligible for a stem cell transplantation, an autologous stem cell transplantation, and those patients are usually young and fit. And we can divide them by the non-transplant eligible patients, so patients usually above 70 years of age or not fit. And when we talk about therapies in newly diagnosed multiple myeloma patients, the word is daratumumab. And Cas already mentioned it very briefly. Maybe you have heard about it already, then it's okay. Daratumumab is an antibody, and you see it here. And daratumumab can bind to a specific receptor, a protein, on the myeloma plasma cell, so the myeloma tumor cell. And this receptor on the myeloma cell is called CD38. So daratumumab is able to bind to CD38 on the myeloma cell. And when it binds, it can attack and kill the myeloma cell in 5 different ways. You don't need to remember, but it's very effective. And like many other drugs, daratumumab was first investigated in the first phase 1 and then in phase 2. And it has been evaluated in a relapse setting a couple of years ago, and it's already approved in that setting. And now it moved to the first line. So daratumumab is in studies added to the standard regimens for both transplant eligible patients as non-transplant eligible patients. And first, I want to tell you about the study in transplant eligible patients, so the younger fit patients. And the study that was presented at ASH is the Griffin study. And those studies have names, and it's because it's easy to remember for the doctor, but it's not easy for you to remember. So I will just talk you through. In the Griffin study, patients were treated with either a standard of care, RVD, that means lenalidomide, bortezomib, dexamethasone, or they had 50% chance to have the addition of daratumumab to that standard treatment. So half of the patients got the DARA treatment and the other half received the standard of care. Patients were treated for 4 cycles, followed by an autologous stem cell transplantation and followed by 2 additional cycles and then 2 years of maintenance therapy. The standard arm received only lenalidomide, which is standard of care nowadays, but the DARA arm received additional daratumumab maintenance. What you can see here is the response at different time points. Here, the end of induction, so before transplant, here after transplantation, here after the 2 additional extra cycles, and here after 12 months of maintenance therapy for DARA RVD versus RVD. And what you can see, only yellow are the people that don't respond. Actually, every patient responds in both arms. And what you can also see is that responses, especially purple and orange, are the best responses. So the complete remission, disappearance of M protein, you see that responses increased over time in both the treatment arms. But what you can also see is that more patients in the DARA RVD arm received a better response. So responses were better with DARA RVD. What you can also see after at least 2 years of follow-up, almost all patients were still alive with progression of the disease. And those are really striking findings. And that means that both treatments are really good. And we need to wait much longer to see whether the addition of daratumumab to RVD becomes better than it is now. But now, both treatments are really good.
The next question we ask, is there still a role for autologous stem cell transplant for patients treated for multiple myeloma? There are actually 3 studies I'm going to talk you through and then conclude if there is still a role. The first study is the FORTE trial. Almost 500 patients were included and they were divided in 3 groups. The first group got KCD, which is carfilzomib, a proteasome inhibitor, with cyclophosphamide and dexamethasone for 4 cycles, then got the stem cell transplant and 4 more cycles. Another third of patients got carfilzomib with lenalidomide and dexamethasone with the stem cell transplant, and then again, 4 times KRD. And then 1/3 of the patients didn't receive a stem cell transplant, but 12 times KRD. Here on the left, you see the response rates. And in the middle, it's the highest, almost 90% had a VGPR, so a very good partial response or better. And that arm was the one with a stem cell transplant with KRD, so carfilzomib, lenalidomide, and dexamethasone. If you look at the PFS, so the progression-free survival, remember the higher the better. You see the highest line is the blue line, and the blue line was the people treated with a carfilzomib, lenalidomide, dexamethasone, with a stem cell transplant. So you see that after 36 months, which is 3 years, the highest percentage of patients, 78, were alive without progression of the disease. So yes, from this study, there's still benefit of stem cell transplant. The second study is the EMN2 or HOVON95 study. In this study, patients were treated with VCD and then they were randomized between receiving VMP, which is bortezomib, melphalan, prednisone, or a stem cell transplant. Almost 1,200 patients were included. And further, previously, there was shown that there was a better progression-free survival for patients who were treated with the stem cell transplant. The red line is higher than the blue line. There wasn't a difference in overall survival when they were followed up for almost 70 months. But now we have a longer follow-up. This was the previous follow-up, and now it's almost 84 months, and you see that the lines start to diverge, with the blue line being the higher line, the patients who received a stem cell transplant. So again, it seems there is still a benefit of a stem cell transplant in the first-line treatment. The third study is the IFM 2009 study. Patients were treated with RVD, lenalidomide, bortezomib, and dexamethasone, without a stem cell transplant or with a stem cell transplant. What you see here is the progression-free survival, the red line being the patients with a stem cell transplant, which is higher than the blue line. So there's a benefit for those patients. And if you look at the survival, it didn't change, but then people were treated with the next regimen. So to summarize, is there still a role for autologous stem cell transplant? Based on these three studies, I would say yes, yes, yes. It's good to remember that daratumumab wasn't added in those studies because it's fairly new. So what the effect will be on daratumumab if there's still a benefit of stem cell transplant is hard to tell because they were not included in these studies.
As you all might know, is that in previous decades, we treated newly diagnosed myeloma patients for a limited period, for example, for 9 months, and then stopped treating the patient until the disease relapsed. But now a lot of studies show that intensifying treatment or giving continuous treatment with maintenance, it induces better, deeper and longer responses. And one of the things you can do to intensify treatment is to give consolidation treatment cycles. And that means you give extra cycles of treatment after stem cell transplantation. And Cas already mentioned this trial, the EMN-02 HOVON-95 study, in which those patients were first treated the same and then were randomized between VMP versus stem cell transplantation. But another important thing that they investigated in the trial was whether giving two additional cycles of RVD, bortezomib, lenalidomide, dexamethasone, was better and was beneficial as compared when you don't give extra cycles. So what I'm going to tell you about is whether extra two cycles is beneficial. The red line, this is again the progression-free survival. And what you can see is patients who received those two extra cycles after the VMP or stem cell transplantation had a longer progression-free survival as compared to patients who did not get the consolidation cycles. And what you can also appreciate is that the patients who received the two additional cycles more often had a complete response, so disappearance of M protein. So that means that intensifying treatment with two cycles more leads to a better survival and response. Now let's move to the non-transplant eligible patients, so the elderly. And again, it's all about daratumumab. Like I told you, the most important studies that were presented at ASH were longer follow-up results of the two largest phase 3 trials in non-transplant patients, the addition of daratumumab to lenalidomide dexamethasone. This was investigated in the MAIA trial, again a name, or the addition of daratumumab to VMP, bortezomib, melphalan, prednisone, the ELCIUM trial. And what you can see is is when daratumumab is added to either RD, Lendex in purple, or added to VMP, the red line, the higher, like Cas says, the higher the line, the better. So the progression-free survival is better when daratumumab is added to the standard of care. And in the Netherlands, Dara VMP is already approved and we already can give it to the patients. Dara RD, not yet, but it will be approved maybe in the near future, but it depends on in which country and how are the
reimbursement
is. This is also very interesting because daratumumab is beneficial. We already talked about it a lot. But there's a couple of disadvantages of daratumumab, and that is that you need to administer it intravenously, so into the vein. And that means that a patient has to be admitted in the hospital for hours, and it can also induce reactions after infusion. So what they did is the pharmaceutical industry made daratumumab subcutaneously. So you can give it under the skin, and then it reduces the administration time and it gives also a little less infusion-related reactions. But then you also need to know, is it as effective as the daratumumab intravenously? So what this study did, the Pleiades study, was they compared the response of patients treated with daratumumab subcutaneously versus daratumumab intravenously, and in different patient groups and with different regimens. And what you can appreciate here is that the response rates, dara subcutaneously versus daratumumab intravenously, is comparable. Again, comparable, again, comparable. So daratumumab is not subcutaneously is not only faster and less infusion reaction, but it's also as effective as the intravenous formulation. So it has an advantage, and I hope it will be approved very shortly.
All right. For the early relapse, I want to talk you through three studies that were based on an immunomodulatory agent, a proteasome inhibitor with anti-CD38. The studies are Apollo, CMRG04, and IKEMA.
There's already a question, but is it do we need to do it already, or
maybe?
Oh, maybe at the end.
We'll continue. Yeah,
continue with the presentation, and we will have the question later.
We have enough time. So the first study is the Apollo study. In the Apollo study, pomalidomide with dexamethasone was combined with or without daratumumab subcutaneously for patients with a relapse of the myeloma who were treated with one or more previous lines. This already has been investigated in a phase 1 and phase 2 study, and they found it was safe and effective. So now this combination entered the phase 3 study to compare it between each other. Over 300 patients entered the study, and what did they see? The purple line is the patients who were treated with daratumumab, pomalidomide, and dexamethasone, and this line is higher than the yellow line, so the patients who were treated without daratumumab. So it's more effective. And on the right, you see that the overall response rate is 69%, meaning that 69% of all the patients we treated with the combination therapy responded with a decrease of the M protein compared with 46% in the other arm. So the conclusion here is that daratumumab with pomalidomide and dexamethasone is more effective than without a daratumumab. The second study is the CMRG04 study. Different combination of names, but in this study, people were treated with daratumumab, dexamethasone, and cyclophosphamide, with or without pomalidomide. Also, for patients with a relapse of the disease, with one or more previous lines, who never had daratumumab or pomalidomide before, 120 patients were included. And what did you see? The blue arm is the people who were treated with the four drugs, and the red arm with only three. And the progression-free survival is much higher for the blue arm. So that means that more people are alive without progression of the disease. What they did next was people who were treated in arm B, so without the pomalidomide, could still get the pomalidomide, and the progression-free survival improved in 50% of the patients, so you could still get it later. So that's good to know. Also good to remember is the side effects, and mostly neutropenia, which is a low form of white blood cells with a chance of infection. So it's always good to keep in mind that more effective with more drugs also can keep more side effects. The last study for relapse refractory myeloma for early relapse is the IKEMA study. In this study, patients were treated with carfilzomib and dexamethasone with or without isatuximab, which looks like daratumumab. It's a impressive graph here. I will talk you through it. The two highest lines, blue and red, are dotted, and it means the patients who were MRD negative. That means that the minimal residual disease, the sort of very, very sensitive way of measuring disease, was negative. They didn't find in the bone marrow the myeloma cells or the plasma cells. They, of course, had the highest progression-free survival because it was more clean, compared to people who were still, where you still found the disease. In those two lines, the blue line is the people who were treated with isatuximab, carfilzomib, and dexamethasone was higher than for the patients who were treated without isatuximab. On the right, you see some columns, with the blue column being the people who were treated with all three drugs, where the response rate was higher and more deep responses. And on the bottom, you see that more people reached the MRD negative state, meaning that is also in the deep, there was no plasma cells or myeloma cells found. So to conclude, this regimen, isatuximab, carfilzomib, dexamethasone, gave a longer and a deeper response. These are the combinations with drugs we know, but more exciting news is coming from the ASH with fairly new treatments like bispecifics. How do they work? You have to look at it as a protein with two arms. One arm, it's called CD3, which is on your own T cells. And the other arm binds a protein on the myeloma cell, the plasma cell. So what the protein does is bring them together. So it brings your defense cells, your white blood cells, to the sick cells, and then combine them and makes the T cell kill the plasma cell. And this pharmaceutical company produced a bispecific which is binding to this protein, GPRC5D, on the plasma cell. But there are many more proteins. One of them is BCMA, and the other one is FCRH5. You don't have to remember that, but the good thing to know is that bispecifics bind two things, the T cell and the plasma cell, and brings them together to kill them. So this might be an interesting and impressive table, but there were six studies with different targets, and they were all phase one, which means that they're very early in the development. And the patients who entered this study had a median prior lines of 5 or 6. So they had quite a lot of therapies already they had, but there was still a chance of 50 up till 80% they responded. So it's a high percentage chance that the patients responded to this new therapy. One of the side effects we call cytokine release syndrome, and the cytokines can be released when this is given, and that can give high fever, low blood pressure, and people can get really sick and even can be admitted to the intensive care unit. So there was a special attention in these studies if this was safe, and luckily only a low percentage of patients developed a cytokine release of grade 3 or higher, so it's fairly safe. But remember, this is all phase 1, short-term follow-up, and before this can be a standard care of treatment, we need much more phase 2 studies, where they look at the safety and effectiveness, and more phase 3 studies, when the bispecifics are compared to other studies. So this will be, for the upcoming years on the ASH, probably one of the topics.
And I have the pleasure to tell you all about CAR T-cell therapy, and it's just like the bispecifics. It's an enormous advantage, and it's really breaking news also this ASH. And first I want to tell you something about how CAR T-cells work. For CAR T-cells, this is a very impressive slide, but I talk you through. With CAR T-cells, we use the patient's, or so your own immune system, to recognize the myeloma and kill it. Myeloma is a really smart disease, and it becomes invisible for your own immune system. He has a lot of features to do that. And what we are going to do by CAR T-cells is we change your own immune system so it can recognize the tumor again. So in this case, the myeloma cells. What we do, we collect the T cells from the body of the patient, just like a stem cell collection for autologous stem cell transplantation. And then the T cells are going to the laboratory, and they get more information about how the tumor looks like. And then the CAR T cell make new receptors on its surface in order to recognize the myeloma cell. And when the T cell has this receptor on its surface, it's called a CAR T cell. So CAR T cell is actually your own T cell, but with extra information about the recognition of the myeloma cell. Then the CAR T cells are redirected in the body, and in the body they meet the myeloma cells, and now they recognize them and they're going to kill it. So what all the studies do is they collect the stem cells. It's called apheresis, but the manufacturing process here that takes a couple of weeks. So sometimes the patients need a little bit of therapy in between. After 2 to 4 weeks, the patient is admitted in the hospital, get a little bit of chemotherapy, and then infuse the CAR T cells into the body. And then what we need to do is wait and look whether the patient responds, and also look for adverse events. Because just like Cas said, you can imagine You redirect the T cells in the body. The T cells recognize the tumor, and you get an enormous T cell. You get an enormous immune response, and that can look like you have an infection with the fever and the chills and low blood pressure. So it can be dangerous. So you must look really good after the patients. Very impressive slide. But what I want to mention is there were 11 ASH presentations. So it was really hard investigating 9 different CAR T cell products. So there are a lot. It means that we are really looking forward to get this in practice. All have the same target on the myeloma tumor cell. It's all BCMA. And again, just like the bispecifics, it's all early phase 1 trials. So trials that to find the recommended CAR T cell dose. Also in those studies, all patients were treated, were heavily pre-treated with 4, 5, 6 median prior lines. Luckily, we only saw very few cytokine release syndromes of high grade. So that was good. And again, really encouraging overall response rates of up to 100%. So really, really good responses in patients, but again, we must warn you, it's really a short follow-up. It is possible that the patient responds really short and then relapse again. So we really need to follow up those patients longer and try to get those CAR T cells to phase 2 and 3 trials to investigate whether this effect holds. But it's still very, very encouraging. And then lastly, about the myeloma, another new treatment approach, that's the antibody drug conjugates, or ADC. And ADCs work like this. You have an antibody, just like daratumumab, that can bind to a receptor on the myeloma cell. But the difference between daratumumab and an antibody drug conjugate is that the antibody has a package of chemotherapy. And when the antibody binds to the myeloma cell, it can release its package of chemotherapy very locally. So it's really targeted therapy. And there are more ADCs investigated in trials, but I want to point out one because it's already added to another regimen, pomalidomide dexamethasone. And that antibody drug conjugate is called belantamab mafodotin. It's really hard. I call it Belamaf. The phase 1 L-gonine study investigated 37 patients. They were not so heavily pre-treated as with the bispecifics or CAR T cells. They had 3 prior median lines. And of the 34 evaluable patients, almost 90% responded to this regimen. And importantly, also the patients who did not respond anymore to immunomodulatory agents such as lenalidomide, bortezomib, and daratumumab, all had a response on this regimen. So very promising in patients who are pre-treated. But on the contrary, they found something disadvantages, and that was keratopathy. It's really hard for me, sorry. Over 50% of patients had that eye toxicity. And it's like a corneal ulceration with at least a risk of vision loss. So it's really important toxicity in over half of patients. And that led to a dose reduction of this Belamaf. And now lower doses will be investigated in this trial. So this is a really good example how important it is to find the recommended dose, because you want good response rates, but you don't want a very severe eye toxicity or other toxicity. Now let's move on AL amyloidosis for the last couple of slides. And I think the most important presentations were about the Andromeda trial. That is a trial, a phase 3 trial in newly diagnosed AL amyloidosis patients. And those patients were treated either with VCD, bortezomib, cyclophosphamide, dexamethasone. and that's a standard of care, at least in the Netherlands. Or again, daratumumab was added to this regimen. So it was 50-50 chance to get one of those. Patients who were treated with daratumumab and VCD received also 2 years of maintenance with daratumumab, but the VCD arm did not get this maintenance. On the left-hand side, you see the best response in the Dara VCD versus the standard without daratumumab, and you see a big difference in response. And if you look at the right-hand side, you see the progression-free survival between the both arms, and you see that the daratumumab VCD arm is higher than the VCD arm, so the progression-free survival is better with daratumumab. And it's really interesting, they did not look only to the patients who were still alive without progression of the disease, but they also looked that no organ function worsened. So this is a good regimen also to prevent organs to dysfunction. And lastly, we want to tell you about a presentation about a collaboration that was started between at least 13 European hospitals to assess real-world data about AL amyloidosis. And as you might know, AL amyloidosis is a really rare disease. So per country, you don't have a lot of patients. And to increase all the knowledge and how to treat patients, collaborations are really warranted. And for AL amyloidosis, it has been moving on really quickly. And currently, there are almost 3,000 patients already involved, and it will only get more. So that's really promising and nice.
So to conclude this session, what we'd like you to take home is that the treatment in myeloma is evolving rapidly with a lot of new combinations of existing therapy and new therapy coming up. That daratumumab, which is now given in a relapse-remitting disease, maybe can come to the first-line treatment in the future, and that there's still a role for autologous stem cell transplant nowadays, and that there are new combinations of the medicine we know, and most exciting that there's a lot of new promising agents coming up, like the CAR T cells, the trained T cells, the bispecific, the protein who binds, and many more. I hope this was clear for everybody. If not, we are happy to take any questions.
Thank you, doctors, for this wonderful presentation. We know it's very difficult to summarize all the things presented at us, a lot of information, a lot of updates. So thank you very much for summarizing that for the patient community and also for make it understandable for all of us. Just quickly remind the people we have in the webinar that there are two ways to ask questions. So you can use the microphone. If you use the right hand button, I will unmute you so you can ask the question. And the other way is to send the question in writing. I know some of you already did that. So we are going to start with the question. One of them is, in my experience, daratumumab, it is a weekly infusion. Is subcutaneous daratumumab still weekly or is it more frequent?
That's a really good question. And actually, daratumumab, it depends. If you get daratumumab subcutaneously upfront, so you start with daratumumab, it's the same schedule as you would give, you get it IV. So first you start with every week, and after two cycles you go bi-weekly, and after six cycles you go, you get daratumumab every 4 weeks, and it doesn't matter if you get it subcutaneously or intravenously. But some patients move from an intravenous formula to subcutaneous formula, and then you just go on in your own schedule. So you don't need to intensify the frequency.
Thank you very much, doctor. The next question, what do you think about retreatment with the same or another anti-CD38?
That's a good question as well. This is also really depending if previously patients were refractory or not. So it means if you were treated with daratumumab and the disease progressed, then it's not really logic to give it again because you already proved that the myeloma is stronger than the daratumumab. But if you had it somewhere in the past and it reacted and it stopped for what reason, then it's all, yeah, it's possible to try, but it's for every patient it's different, and it depends on what has been given in the past and if it reacted or not.
And maybe I can say a little bit more about that. We know that if a patient gets daratumumab, then the malignant plasma cells, so the myeloma tumor cells, will lose their CD38. So the binding site of daratumumab to the myeloma cell. So eventually the patient becomes refractive to daratumumab, but there are now some really new data that sometimes when you wait long, eventually CD38 will come up on the surface of the myeloma cells again. So you can hypothesize that daratumumab will work again, or maybe it doesn't work, but maybe if you give isatuximab, the brother or the sister of daratumumab, then it might work also. And there are some, there was one presentation at ASH in which patients got isatuximab while they were already treated before with daratumumab, and there were still some responses. I don't know the exact percentage, but.
Thank you very much for that answer. The next question, what is the difference between CAR T therapies and BiTEs, bispecific antibodies, in terms of efficacy, side effects, or weight of administration?
Good question. I think to start with, like how the mechanism of action is different. So the bispecific is a protein. It's available, and you can give it in the subcutaneously or intravenously, depends on the study. The CAR T cell, of course, the most different is that it's a different manufacturing time. So you first need to take the T cells, train them, and then give them back. So it takes a little bit longer, which is challenging sometimes. But in the end, they have the same effect that the T cell, trained or guided by the bispecific, kills the myeloma cells. And when T cells, when the immune system is active, they can produce all kinds of cytokines, which give the cytokine release syndrome. So a part of the side effects are the same with the cytokine release, which is can be really heavily. And luckily, in these phase one studies, and you cannot really compare them, the percentage of a grade 3 or higher cytokine release syndrome was 10% or around it or below. And you can also not really good compare the efficacy. It's all phase one. So I'm really looking forward to the future where maybe bispecifics and CAR T cells can be compared in studies as well. So it's too early to actually say which one is better.
And maybe I don't want to interrupt again, but I think for bispecifics, it's also that you give it once in 3 weeks and then continuous until the patient progress, relapsed. And CAR T cell therapy, you give it once, and then you hope the T cells will persist in the body for a long time. And all those CAR T cell studies also mention how long the T cells are available in the body. And there are a lot of studies going on, also preclinical, so in mice, or to increase the persistence in the body of the CAR T cells. So you don't need, so they work long.
Yeah, in fact, there is a question around the things that you just said, comparing CAR T given just once and BiTEs given until progression. So one of the problems of CAR T is that they are very expensive. And in this case, which one will be more expensive? I know it's a difficult question.
Well, first, of course, it needs to be approved, and then the negotiations will start with the pharmaceutical company to lower the price. But the manufacturing of CAR T is really expensive, but yeah, you only need it once if it works for a long time. So I think bispecifics, they're readily available, might be cheaper, I don't know, but if you need it for a long time and you give it first, you give it weekly and then go to every 2 weeks and every month. If you have it for a very long time, of course, it becomes more expensive. So it's too early to say, because we still need it to be approved, but I think both will be expensive. Yeah.
Well, there's a lot of questions around CAR T. One of them is, you said that CAR T is promising. How many more years can we call it promising when real life all patients relapse within a year of the given treatment? Do you think it will ever be curative treatment? What would you suggest if a patient had two choices left, belamaf and CAR T?
Oh, that's really, really, really hard. We hope it's curative, but of course, it's so early to say. Mostly it takes more than a few years to be from the first investigations to readily available for everybody. Also thinking about the logistics and the time to get the T cells and produce them. So it won't be available for everybody in the near future. So mostly in trials, and then when it's accepted and a phase 3 trial, then it will be available.
But I think what is really promising is that some CAR T cells are already moved to phase 2. So they are combined with other drugs, such as daratumumab or in CARTITUDE, I think it's with carfilzomib. So they already moved a little bit towards the first line. The time is always your enemy, because those treatments, they move to earlier lines, but you need time to look whether the treatment is effective, and the more effective, the longer you must wait. Do you understand? And so I think if it's possible, try to see whether there are studies around your home to look whether there's a CAR T cell study available. But we need time to look to the long-term results.
And I think belantamab mafodotin is will be more early available than CAR T cell, because it's already further in all those phases.
Yeah, thank you very much. The next question: you said there is still a role for transplant in the future. With the development of CAR T and BiTEs with high efficacy rates, do you ever think there might be a shift to the use of immunotherapy and alternative to transplant?
Good question. The studies we showed on the benefit of stem cell transplant was with the induction treatment, even without daratumumab. So we don't know what that adding might change for the role of the stem cell transplant, let alone the role of the CAR T and the bispecific. If they are approved for the relapse refractory and they're very effective, then I think in the future it will be put in trial for first line maybe, and then we'll see. I hope that in the future only immune therapy is needed and no chemotherapy. It's still early. I can understand why we have these questions, but it's still too early to say. Yeah.
Well, thank you very much. Next question: is there an alternative treatment under development as maintenance instead of lenalidomide?
Yes, although the most studies report lenalidomide as maintenance, because that improved the progression-free survival and overall survival in the patients. But there are possibilities to give something else as maintenance, and most commonly used is bortezomib. But as you might know, bortezomib, if you give it for a longer time, you have more chance for neuropathy. And as we showed in this presentation, there are a lot of studies going on when daratumumab is added to lenalidomide. As maintenance therapy. And we will know, I think, in a couple of years whether the addition of daratumumab to lenalidomide maintenance will be more effective as well. And if that is the case, then you might get not only lenalidomide, but also daratumumab. Keeping in mind that lenalidomide is just a pill. And daratumumab is a subcutaneous injection, or not now even intravenously, so you have to come to the hospital. But yeah, if it's more effective, that's you have to wait those two. Yeah.
Well, thank you very much. Next question: how do you utilize MRD in real clinical trials? In clinical practice?
Not.
Not yet. No. We know the deeper the response, the longer the progression-free survival is. So if you have a really good response, a very good partial response or complete response, that's good. And if you have a MRD negative response, so in the deep, we don't see any plasma cells, multiple myeloma cells, we think it's better and a longer PFS, but it's not put in practice yet. But a lot of studies, of course, look at it, because they want to show if it's predictive as well. It's not put in practice.
But what is really impressive is I showed you the Griffin trial when daratumumab was added to RVD, lenalidomide, bortezomib, dexamethasone, and we don't only have the Griffin trial, we also have the Versailles trial, which actually does exactly the same, adding daratumumab to the standard of care RVD. But when what they do is they give maintenance until the patient has been MRD negative. So you don't see myeloma at all anymore in the most specific sensitive way. And then they stop treatment and then they look what happens. So those are the first studies that using MRD in changing treatment, stopping or starting treatment. And also we will learn from those trials what to do with MRD.
Thank you very much. It's really interesting. And next question, was there any presentation at us about COVID-19 in myeloma patients? Is COVID more severe in myeloma patients? And how is myeloma treatment handling around the COVID pandemic?
We didn't see any presentation on myeloma and COVID on the ASH, but it's of course a really relevant question those days, what to do with the treatment. And I would say it's really patient specific what to do. So you can imagine if you have myeloma, new myeloma with a lot of problems or kidney problems or bone problems, you need to be treated to prevent new problems and to get it better. Then of course it's more important to start treatment than delaying it. On the other hand, if you had a stem cell transplant 2 years ago and are on maintenance therapy, then there's less urgency to continue and there might be a little bit more benefit of stopping treatment for a little bit. But it's so patient specific on what were the symptoms of the disease, how far in the treatment, how well is the response, that this would be a discussion with your own doctor in the room to see, do I still benefit of the maintenance or can I maybe stop it to be more safe? So we have to discuss it, I guess, with our own doctor, because it's really current question.
Well, thank you very much. The next question, if you have low number of T cells from previous chemotherapy, how come they are going to cut T cells from the CAR T therapy? I am doing right now Dara, cyclophosphamide and dexamethasone. What will be the next in a new relapse?
So what's the question? How do we get the T cells if they're low?
Yeah, and after that, also, he's asking that he's with daratumumab right now, cyclophosphamide and dexamethasone. What would be the next therapy for if relapse again?
Okay, so first of all, when you want to be started with apheresis to collect the T cells, there has to be a certain level of T cells. So most of the treatments lower the T cells, so then you have to stop for a little bit to measure the T cells in the blood, and if they go up and they're above a certain level, then you can try to collect them. So that this also in practice, it's tricky, but that's the way to do it. And the second question is now on daratumumab, cyclophosphamide and dexamethasone. It depends always for every patient. It depends what were the previous treatments, what was effective and what was not. So if you have progression under daratumumab, you would not continue that and to look back. If you had a very good response previously on an IMiD, you would choose an IMiD, the immune modulatory drug. If there was a very good response on Velgate, you can try that again with a combination or the newer generation carfilzomib if it's safe. So for every patient, look back what worked, which under which therapy I was progressive and which combinations are available now to give. Current therapy, or always look if there's a study in the neighborhood in my hospital which I can be included to maybe get by specific therapy, CAR T cell therapy, or other new therapy.
The next question regarding CAR T as well, when you combine CAR T and other myeloma drugs in trials, how do you know if it's CAR T or the other drugs that are efficient? Do patients respond to drugs again after CAR T if they have become refractory to them before CAR T?
I think that most of the CAR T cell studies don't combine yet, but if you want to know if the adding of a medicine works, then you divide all the patients into groups. In a phase 3 style trial, that you do arm A, you say CAR T plus medicine XYZ, and arm B, it's only CAR T. And then, of course, when there are enough patients in it, you can see on the average if adding something has a positive or maybe negative result if there's more side effects.
regarding also regarding CAR T. In this case, they are asking CAR T can be used for AL amyloidosis patients. Is there any clinical trial on AL amyloidosis?
Not that we are aware of. But I can imagine, because AL amyloidosis is the problem is in the same cell, a white blood cell, namely the plasma cell. So usually it is when something is beneficial in myeloma, patients get treatment for AL amyloidosis, get the same treatment eventually as myeloma. So I think there are no studies yet, but I think when CAR T cell is beneficial, is proven to be beneficial, it will come for AL amyloidosis as
maybe,
well.
Maybe. Yeah.
But it's too early.
Let's see what happened then. So the next question, how do you choose DLD, DMPV, or BRD for non-transplant eligible induction?
Again?
Sorry, a lot of acronyms. How do you choose DLD, DMPV, or BRD for non-transplant eligible induction?
Yeah, it's an important question, and the short answer is it depends on the what is reimbursed and approved in your country, because here in the Netherlands we always give VMP, so bortezomib, melphalan, prednisone, now added with daratumumab, and we don't give lenalidomide, dexamethasone that often, only in certain cases, so it really depends on your country. And sometimes you give the patient something because the patient wants oral drugs, because he lives far from the hospital, cannot come for all the bortezomib injections all the time. Sometimes because of kidney dysfunction, you give that kind of treatment, etc. So it's patient dependent and country dependent.
And to add side effect dependence, some people have neuropathy already because of the myeloma, and you don't want to worsen that with the Velcade, the bortezomib. So then it's easier to choose for an immunomodulatory drug.
Well, thank you very much for answering all those questions. I mean, that was the last question. Thank you very much for explaining everything and all the summarizing everything that presented at us regarding myeloma and AL amyloidosis. Remind all people here that the webinar has been recorded and will be available in the MP website, in the MP YouTube channel, and also they can access it through our social media channels. So thank you very much, and have a nice evening.
Have a nice evening.
You too.